Good morning, everyone. I was waiting on the countdown, but there was no countdown. I thought I still had a few minutes. Glad that you are here, and glad that we can come and worship Jesus together today. We're going to stand together, and we're going to sing, "Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary." Let's stand together, if you can. To dwell in us, and we need to make his living space in us clean and pure, and know that we got a lot of stuff around the world that drives us away, but we need more of Jesus in our lives. I'm going to ask Brett, if you would, to lead us in prayer this morning, please. Amen. You can be seated. And as he was praying, I was just thinking that we do want to say thank you to all those who came out to the baby shower yesterday for Shelly and Michelle, and looking forward to their new babies. But they are still accepting gifts. So if you didn't get to come out yesterday, I'm sure they'd still take some diapers and all that kind of stuff. You'll never have too many diapers. Never. And But we are thankful for all those who helped get that set up, and those who came out, and was a blessing to them. We got some announcements, and I'm going to try to make them quick, but we got a lot of things going on. Last week was our building fund offering, and our first Sunday of the month. And just wanted to let you know how much we collected, $1,160, and so that is a blessing. And but you don't have to just give on the first Sunday of the month. You can give anytime. There's building fund envelopes there in the back, and you can get you one of those, put it in, or if you write a check, you can just write in the memo building fund, or you can go on Tithely, our giving app, or you can go on our website, fimbcconova.org, and there's a spot where you can mark for building fund. So thank you for giving, and we're looking forward to seeing how much we actually have in there. We're very, very close to $200,000, which is awesome, and looking forward to seeing how God is going to continue to bless there. Evening Bible study tonight at 6, we're going to be looking at why do we believe that there is a heaven and a hell. I think it's very important that we know these things. I'm glad that this is not it. I'm glad there's so much more than this. I'm glad we've got a heaven to gain, and we don't have to go to hell. There's a way of escape through Jesus Christ. Let's see, Wednesday youth group at 6:30 to 8. Please bring your kids out to that. We've had some good couple Wednesday nights. We're not running the vans right now, but we're still having pretty good crowds, which is awesome. Nursery and children's church. I had a problem saying it this morning in the 9 o'clock. You try to say nursery and children's church sign up sheet three times fast, it doesn't work. Those sign up sheets over there for the nursery and the children's church, very important. We need to get people signed up. We need to get people working. So if you are not part of that list, go ahead and make yourself part of that list and help us out, because we need to get the gospel out. We need to get the gospel to the kids, and we need to give opportunities for the parents to be able to listen attentively to the gospel message as well. Senior ministry Thursday at 6:30. You don't have to be a senior to be here. It's to help our shut-ins out, and so be here across the street in the fellowship hall at 6:30. Let's see. Prayer vigil for Eric. We got a couple of Eric's kids with us. We are praying for Eric and Isaiah as they go in for the transplant on Tuesday. They're heading up to Pittsburgh today, but they're gonna have a prayer vigil at River Cities Community Church. That's the round church on Route 60. It's going to be at 6 o'clock tomorrow evening. They are going to be live streaming it on their church's Facebook page, so I will try to share that. We're going to try to be there, but I'll try to share that on our Facebook page so that anybody wants to watch, you can do that. But just be in prayer, and we need to keep praying. We've been praying for Eric for a long time now, and let's pray that that this transplant does what it is supposed to do and gives Eric many, many more years of life. He's a blessing to many, and I'm thankful that God is working this out for him. So pray about that. Come to that 6 o'clock tomorrow evening. We're in shoebox. Like, this is the last minute for shoebox time. Debbie is over there all the time. Go wrap you a box. Go fill a box. It's going to be good. But I want to let you know, next week, we're not going to be in this building for this service. We're going to be across the street for our service. All right? So make plans to go over there. We're going to have our adult Sunday school in here. If that makes sense, we're going to switch it up. Adult Sunday school in here. Mr. Sunday School teacher. And then we're going to have church service across the street. All right, same times, 9 o'clock and 11 o'clock, and but we are going to be dedicating and praying over our shoe boxes that we're sending out. But we need to get as much help as we can this last week, getting as many shoe boxes in as we can, because the more shoe boxes, it's not about, hey, we're going to have this many shoe boxes. It's about this many kids are going to be able to hear the gospel. That's the way we need to look at it. This many kids are going to receive God's gospel, and so please help us out with that, and we're looking forward to next week's service. Yep. Amen. Very important. We want to get the gospel message out, and that's one of the best ways that we can do that. Sunday evening youth group will be starting back at the beginning of the new year. We're taking a break, but Mark said he wants to start the new year off with a bang. So invite as many people as we can. That's usually about 8 years old and up for Sunday evening youth group. And so let people know that we're starting back the beginning of new year. Any other announcements? All right. If not, let's stand together, and we're going to sing Glory to His Name. Glory. seated. And that's what we want to bring is glory to His name. It is not about us. It is not about what we can do. It's all about what He has already done. And we want to bring glory and honor and praise to the name of Jesus Christ. We'll go ahead and sing our next song. You are, actually, before we do that, I missed it. I didn't put it in my notes, and I missed it. We do want to recognize our veterans this morning, and we got a video to show. James, hold off on that for just a second. We appreciate all of our veterans, all those who have shown great courage and sacrifice for our nation. We would not be a nation if it were not for those who have given their time and their service for our great country. And we appreciate all the sacrifices that are made. Many in this room, not only those who served, but families of those who have served, who have sacrificed and helped our country be who she is. And so, James, go ahead and hit that video for us, please.
December 7, 1941, a date which will live in infamy.
Today, our very freedom came under attack in a series of deliberate and deadly terrorist acts.
Recognize those who have served in our armed forces. If you would please stand so we can recognize your service to our country. Thank you very much, and we appreciate your service and the families of those who have served. We know probably most of us has somebody in our lives that we know that served, and we thank you so much for making that sacrifice so that our country can have the freedoms that we enjoy. I'm thankful for them, and we do want to pray for them and pray for those who have not only suffered bodily injury but emotional injury as well. And some people are carrying wounds that we might not be able to see, and we want to pray for them through the trials that they're going through. Let's go ahead and ask a blessing over our veterans. Father, we love you. God, we thank you so much that you have shown us a true example of sacrifice in sharing your only begotten Son so that we could have life. Lord, we know that Jesus laid down his life for his friends. And Lord, as we think of our veterans, Lord, those who have sacrificed and given time and energy, Lord, and paid so much for our country, for our freedoms, Lord, we pray that you'd be with them. Lord, we pray that you'd meet their needs and take care of them. Lord, be a blessing to them as they have been a blessing to us. Lord, we do pray that you'd be with those who are suffering from PTSD and other emotional things. Lord, we pray that you would bless them, and I pray that you would be with the doctors, Lord, and be with those who are caring for them, Lord. I pray that you would just help us, Lord, to love our veterans, Lord, to appreciate the service for our country. Lord, we pray that you be with our country. Lord, we pray that you would turn us around, Lord. We know that you can heal this place, but Lord, I pray that you would forgive us from all the sin, the atrocities that we have committed as a nation, and I pray that we would turn our hearts and lives back to you. Father, we know that you're good, and we just want to thank you for it. We love and thank you, and ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We're going to go ahead and sing our next song. You can stay seated. We're going to sing, "You Are My King." I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. Should be our prayer is to bring glory to him and praise to him. And we're thankful that we've got a special song this morning. Amber, it's almost your birthday, right?
Yes.
Tomorrow, right?
Yes.
It's almost her birthday. Tomorrow's her birthday, and she wanted to sing a song today. And looking forward to hearing her sing. And you come on around. Let me get in there.
Looking back from the other side, I can see now with open eyes. Darkest water and deepest pain, I wouldn't trade.
I guess frame next on that one.
looking back from the other side. I can see now with open eyes. Darkest water and deepest pain. I wouldn't trade it for anything. 'Cause my brokenness brought me to you, and these wounds are a story you'll use. So I'm thankful for the scars, 'cause without them I wouldn't know your heart. And I know they'll always tell of who you are. Now I'm standing in confidence with the strength of your faithfulness. And I'm not who I was before. No, I don't have to fear anymore. So I'm thankful for
job, Amber, on a great song. James is trying to DJ back there with that CD. No. No, it wasn't his fault, not this time. But we are thankful for those. One of our visitors this morning, she's been coming for about a month now. Paula, she sang a beautiful song about heaven. Actually, it's three songs about heaven. I'm a poor wayfaring stranger, and then I can only imagine, and then what a day that will be. And it was a beautiful rendition, just thinking about heaven and how good it's going to be, how bad this world is. But we got something to look forward to, and one day we're going to be in heaven, and we're going to surround the throne. With people from every nation, tribe, just worship. Just worship. And when we get to heaven, I don't think it's going to be about our mansion. It's going to be about Jesus. Stand together and let's sing, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain." seated. And Children's Church, that's fifth grade and down. You could be dismissed to Children's Church. Children's Church going down, and we're going to be in Matthew chapter number 5. Amen. Amen. Yes, let's continue to pray. God is in this, and I believe God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. And so let's ask what we can think of, and let's let Him do His work. Amen. We're going to be in Matthew chapter 5 this morning, verses 38 through 42. And we're continuing on this this series in Matthew, this very long series in Matthew. And in the middle of this series on the Sermon on the Mount, we look at this. He's given us a series of, you've heard it said, but I say unto you. And in this section of the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus is speaking about the spirit of the law, not just the letter of the law. And this particular, you've heard it said, but I say unto you, was very difficult for the first century Jew, but I would say it's very difficult for the 21st century American. We're talking about retaliation. And Jesus speaks here, Matthew chapter 5, verse 38. He says, "Ye have heard that it hath been said, an eye for an eye, and a tooth for a tooth. But I say unto you that ye resist not evil, but whosoever shall smite thee on thy right cheek, turn to him the other also. And if any man will sue thee at the law and take away thy coat, let him have thy cloak also. And whosoever shall compel thee to go a mile, go with him twain. Give to him that asketh thee, and from him that would borrow of thee, turn thou not away." Let's pray. Father, we love you. Thank you for who you are. Lord, we thank you for your goodness, your grace. And Lord, we do want to pray for Eric this morning. Lord, we pray that you keep them safe as they travel to Pittsburgh. Lord, be with everything that's going on, all the pre-op things. Lord, we pray that you would bless the actual operation, and pray that you be with the recoveries. Lord, we pray that you would help both Eric and Isaiah and all of their family. Lord, just bring comfort and peace to their hearts this morning. Lord, I pray that you us here. I pray that you would strengthen us. I pray that you'd help us. I pray that you'd show us where we need some work. Lord, we pray that you would do the work in us, and I pray that we would yield ourselves to you so that we would be living like the citizens that you've called us to be. Lord, help us, and we ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Jesus here in Matthew chapter 5, he is speaking against retaliation. This is something that we have trouble with, because when somebody does something to hurt us, our first instinct is to hurt them back, do something to get back at them. Some people, they say they're going to get even. going to get back. They're going to do everything they can to make sure that somebody is going to suffer for the pain that they are feeling. And so Jesus, he is speaking against that mentality. But before we get into what he's actually saying, we got to talk about what he's not saying, okay? Because a lot of people misinterpret this passage, and we don't want to do that. We want to read what is there and not what isn't, all right? So the first thing we're going to look at is Jesus isn't saying don't seek justice through courts. He is not saying that at all. In fact, when we look at the Old Testament law, and we're going to here in a minute, the whole purpose was that if somebody were harmed, they would take the other person to court, and the judge would decide on what the thing would be, the consequence of that action would be. But what took place was, through many years, the rabbis began to reinterpret, and it was personal vendettas. And so instead of taking somebody to court, they twisted it and made it out to be, well, if Molly would punch you in the nose, you just go right ahead and punch her in the nose back, all right? That's the way that the Jewish rabbis don't do that. I'll get in trouble with your parents. But that's the way that the Jewish rabbis would teach, that they would make it out to be a just take personal vendettas. But Jesus is not telling people that you cannot go to court, or that a situation, if somebody breaks into your home, it's not just, hey, turn the other cheek, I'm going to open my door, let you do it again. That's not what he's saying. Take people to court if they need to go to court. And but then there's groups of people that reinterpret this, and they say that Jesus was a pacifist. Jesus would never take anybody to war, never go to war with anybody, and I don't believe that's what he is saying at all, for many reasons. I know the Quakers, they have their beliefs that the war is wrong. Sometimes war is wrong, but sometimes war is necessary. And Jesus is not saying to be pacifist. That's not at all. This section is not about foreign policy or the justice system. It is for individuals in Christ's kingdom. That's it. He's not talking to countries. He's not talking to governments. He's talking to you and me as believers. That's who he's talking to. He's talking to his disciples, his followers, his kingdom citizens. And so what does he say? He says, you have heard it said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. This is pretty familiar. Everybody's heard eye for eye, tooth for tooth. But we're going to go back to the Old Testament law, and we're going to see what Jesus is talking about, what the scribes and the Pharisees were reinterpreting in that day. So turn over to Exodus chapter 21. And I've got 23 on the screen, but we're starting at 22. Exodus chapter 21, 22 through 27 is where we're going to be. Sometimes I get things wrong, believe it or not. All right, Exodus 21, 22. And by the way, this verse, while some pro-abortion activist would say that it proves abortion is okay, I believe it does the exact opposite, because it says that it is not okay. In verse 22, it says, if men strive and hurt a woman with child, a pregnant woman, somebody, the two men are fighting, a pregnant woman gets knocked down or gets hit, whatever, it says, so that her fruit depart from her. And that's the part that we need to talk about. This is not talking about a baby dying. This is not talking about a miscarriage. It's talking about a baby being delivered. If the fruit departs from her, the baby being delivered, and yet no mischief follow, he shall surely be punished according as the woman's husband will lay upon him, and he shall pay as the judges determine. So right here, and this really has nothing to do with our message, but I do want to make it clear that God is pro-life. Every child is important to God. Abortion is not okay. But he says, if no mischief follow, talking about the mischief for the baby, the fruit depart, the baby is delivered, the baby goes out of the womb, and there is no mischief, meaning the baby is whole, the baby is okay, then the guy's going to be punished. The one who pushed the woman, he is going to be punished based upon what the husband and the judge determine. But it says in verse 23, and if any mischief follow, then thou shalt give life for life, meaning that Those unborn, preborn babies are living souls. They are true children. They're not just tissue. They're not just fetus. It is a child. And so he says, but if there's any mischief followed, then thou shalt give life for life. So if you take one life, your life is going to be taken. He goes on, scripture goes on to say, eye for eye, tooth for tooth, hand for hand, foot for foot, burning for burning, wound for wound, stripe for stripe. And if a man shall, if man smite the eye of his servant or the eye of his maid that perish, he shall let them go free for his eye's sake. And if he smite out his manservant's tooth or his maidservant's tooth, he shall let him go free for his tooth's sake. We can keep going, and it talks about like oxen goring somebody, and if it's done it before, then this happens. If it hasn't done it before, then this happens. But just think about this right here. The scripture is saying, the Old Testament law is saying, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. So if you gouge out somebody's eye, expect that the court is going to rule that your eye is going to get gouged out as well. This law is a fair law. It's not too harsh a punishment because, well, that's what you did to somebody else. But it's also not too light that the victim doesn't feel that, well, the court favors the criminal. An eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. It was a very fair system. And I don't believe Jesus saying, that's not what we're going to do now. We're taking the eye for an eye and tooth for a tooth out. But what he's saying is, don't let it be a personal vendetta, because these guys twisted the Old Testament law into this personal vengeance, where I am going to get back at you. I'm going to make sure that you are taken care of. That if you took my ear off, I'm going to take your ear off. If you've burnt me, I'm going to burn you. I'm going to take everything that you have taken from me. It's not a personal vendetta. It's not a personal vengeance, because Jesus says, this is what it says. This is what you've heard. You've heard it said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say unto you, what does he say? He says, first, don't resist evil. Don't stand against evil. Don't oppose evil. And it's not talking about don't oppose sin. Don't. What he's saying is, he says, don't exact revenge. Don't exact revenge on something or somebody that has done something to you. Don't exact that revenge. If there needs to be a trial, then let it go to trial. But there is no sense in a kingdom citizen in exacting revenge on someone else. He says, don't resist evil. But then he says, turn the other cheek. Now, we've all heard this our whole life. Turn the other cheek. And it's something that we kind of wish wasn't in the Bible. We don't like that. We think, well, that makes us feel like doormats, and we feel like we're getting the raw end of the deal. But he says, turn the other cheek. Now, this slapping of the person on the right cheek, it says. He says, whosoever shall smite thee on thy right cheek, turn to him the other also. So if somebody slaps you on the right cheek with their right hand, thinking they're right-handed, it's going to be a backhanded slap. Very degrading. Very, very degrading. And we know that this doesn't just, it's not just talking about a physical slap. This is talking about somebody who degrades you, somebody who has hurt you, somebody who's harmed you. It doesn't have to be a physical action of slapping, but Jesus says, turn the other cheek. Turn the other cheek. Now, this is not something that the Jews were looking for in a Messiah. Someone would say, hey, if somebody does you wrong, let them do it again. That makes no sense. Now, remember, we're talking about an upside-down kingdom that Jesus is bringing, right? Something that man just can't understand. It doesn't make sense. Well, the Jews, they were under Roman oppression, and they were looking for this Messiah to come in riding on a horse and making sure that the Romans pay for what they have done to the Jews. That's what they wanted. But Jesus comes along and says, hey, just turn the other cheek. If somebody's done you wrong, turn the other cheek. Let them do it again. Not something that they would think a Messiah would say. So what does that mean for us? Where Jesus says, if somebody slaps you on the right cheek, go ahead and give him the left one too. How can we turn the other cheek? And I'm just going to go ahead and tell you, turning the other cheek does not come natural to us. You know what comes natural to us? Either a fight or we flee. If somebody does us wrong, some people, they're going to stand up and they're going to beat the other person. They're going to make sure that that does not happen again. Or another natural instinct is, hey, I just got punched. I don't want to get punched again. I'm going to run away from this fight. Now, whatever we are, Jesus says, he says, don't fight and don't flee. He says, stay there with them. Why would he do that? Well, I believe there's several things that we need to look at. And the first one is turn the other cheek to forgive. Turn the other cheek to forgive. He says in verse 39, but I say unto you that ye resist not evil, but whosoever shall smite thee on thy right cheek, turn to him the other also. I want you to notice, it doesn't say who, it just says whosoever. So it doesn't have to be somebody that you love or somebody that's close by. It can be anybody. Whosoever shall smite thee on thy right cheek, turn to him the other also. If somebody has slapped you in the face, has said something awful to you, has hurt you in some manner, he says, don't run away. Jesus commands his followers, don't run when they're hurt. That's hard for us to do, to stick around when somebody has hurt us, does it not? Now, this is not saying that I've been slapped on this cheek, slapped on this cheek, slapped again, slapped again, slapped again, that we're just supposed to grin and bear it. That's not what he's saying. That's not what he's saying. But he's saying that instead of ruining a relationship, forgive. Forgive. Now, forgiveness doesn't necessarily mean reconciliation or anything like that, but it does mean I'm gonna forgive. I'm not gonna dwell on this. I'm not gonna let this run my life. But Jesus commands his followers don't run away when you're hurt. He also commands his followers to be patient with people. We gotta learn patience. One way that I don't want to learn patience is somebody slapped me on the right cheek. That's not the way I want to learn patience. But we gotta learn patience as people. We gotta understand that people are broken, that people are hurting, that people by nature are sinful. There's not one person apart from Jesus Christ who's ever lived a completely perfect life. And a lot of times we expect perfection from the other person, but not from us. We want the other person to be perfect, but we got our own things and we're not going to really talk about. But we need to make sure that we are patient with people and giving them time to grow as people, giving them time to mature, giving them time to understand the truth that is in Jesus Christ. Jesus commands his followers to be vulnerable in relationship because people need to see love, not retaliation. If Bradley and I, I'm not going to use Bradley and Mandy, if Bradley and I, We said some things. I said something about Bradley, probably about his bald head or something like that. And he comes back and says something about my big nose. And then we just go back and forth, back and forth, and back and forth. Is that relationship that I have between Bradley and myself, is that going to be helped or is that going to be hurt? It's going to be hurt. There's got to be at some point a time where I don't want to retaliate anymore. I don't want to get back at him anymore. But I want our relationship to grow as my brother in Christ. That's how we need to be. But many times, Coy does something to me. I'm going to make sure I do that same exact thing back to Coy and make it even worse because Coy deserves it. We have a problem because we don't like to forgive. We don't like to let go. We like to hold on. And just keep holding on to that bitterness, to that anger. We want to hold it on because we want to hold it against that person. And maybe at first we don't do anything, but if we keep holding on to that bitterness and that anger and that wrath, eventually we're going to let that retaliation come. But people need to see love, not retaliation. And I want to give you a prime example of this, turning the other cheek. It's a Sunday school answer. Jesus, who was literally slapped in the face, who was beaten beyond recognition, who had a crown of thorns not just placed on his head, but driven into his head, who had nails in his hands and his feet. He hangs on the cross, and he says, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Jesus didn't hold on to a grudge. Jesus didn't say, "Hey, you know what? These guys, because I haven't done anything wrong, these guys have beaten me, so they deserve to be beaten. These guys have nailed me to a cross, so they deserve to be nailed to a cross." Instead of exacting revenge on them, what he did was offered forgiveness. And not only that, he said, "I am taking your cross myself. What you deserve, I am taking." That's how much love Jesus has. He turned the other cheek when he hung on the cross. Jesus turned the other cheek to forgive. But he also tells us in verse 40 to turn the other cheek and give. He says, "And if any man will sue thee at the law and take away thy coat, let him have thy cloak also." Now, we don't really deal with cloaks that much. Some people wear cloaks. If you wear a cloak, you go right ahead. I don't know much about cloaks, but it's not the way that people have cloaks, cloak and dagger and all that. It's not that kind of cloak. It was basically their outer garment. So the inner garment, basically their unmentionables, their underwear, that would have been called their coat. All right, their coat, something that touched their skin, that was their coat. And then they had their robe, their outer garment, that was called a cloak. And Jesus, he gives this example. He says, "If any man sues you at the law and takes away your coat, go ahead and give him your cloak also. If you're sued for your undershirt, go ahead and give him your coat as well." Now, this cloak was everything to the poor. This was not only their outer garment, but it was also what they would sleep on. It was their tent sometimes. It was their sack to carry things in, and it was their pledge. So like last week we talked about oaths. If I said, "Hey, Coy, let me borrow your phone today, I'll give you my coat, and you can have my coat. It's just a surety that I'm going to give you your phone back." That's basically what these poor people use it as. But what's interesting is that the law said that you couldn't keep that pledge overnight. The pledge could only be in a day, because they needed that coat for a bed covering, because poor people especially would only have one of these cloaks. There was only one that they had. And so Jesus basically says, if somebody sues you for the shirt off your back, go ahead and give them everything else as well. Go ahead and give it all. And we look at that, we say, well, how can you say that, Jesus? How can you do that to these poor people? How can you tell them, just go ahead and give them everything? Doesn't make sense to us, because we want to hold on to everything that's ours, right? We don't want to give anybody any more than what they deserve. Yeah, if the law says I've got to give them my undershirt, now I've got to give my coat too, that doesn't make any sense. What Jesus is saying is, care more about people than a long, drawn-out fight. Perhaps it would have been a longer court session. Yeah, here's your coat, but now let's see, we've got to give you a cloak. He says, no, go ahead and do it. Go ahead and give it to him now. How can Jesus say something like that? That just seems mean. Taking everything. I don't mean to take your coat. You don't have to take your coat off, David. I wasn't talking to you specifically. Just perfect timing. Anyway, he says, if a man will sue thee at the law, take away thy coat and let him have thy cloak also. So you don't have anything. Jesus says, give it all. Give it all away. Give it all away. Because people are more important than anything. More than possessions. More than a fight. People are more important. But then he says, just a little bit later in this sermon, in chapter 6, now Jesus didn't say this is verse 1, this is verse 2. He just preached this message. So in chapter 6, we get to verse 28 of Matthew 6. He says, "And why take ye thought for raiment, clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow, they toil not, neither do they spin. And yet I say unto you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Wherefore, if God so clothed the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall he not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? So if you're looking at this part of the sermon, be like, well, Jesus is absolutely crazy because he's telling me to give away all of my earthly possessions, to give away my coat, when that's my bed, that's my tent, that's my sack, that's everything that I have. She says, give it away. But he says, just a little bit later, he says, don't worry about that. Don't worry about that. I got you covered. He says, if God can clothe the lilies of the field, how much more is he going to clothe you? He's going to give you what you need. There's no question. Your need is going to be taken care of. So just give. Care about people. Care about people in that relationship. Number three, he says, turn the other cheek and go farther. Go farther. Look what he says in verse 41. And whosoever shall compel thee, that's basically a force, shall compel thee to go a mile, go with him twain. Two. He says, if somebody tells you to go 1 mile with them, go two. Now, we don't understand this because we don't live like this. We're not under Roman oppression. We have some government situations that we don't all like, and we don't like government overreach. But here's some government overreach that we haven't yet attained to here in the United States of America. A Roman soldier could come up to you at any time, any day, it didn't matter, and say, you're going to carry my backpack for a mile. Now, the law was they could only force them to go 1 mile or 1,000 paces. That was as far as they could go with that backpack. And Jesus says, if somebody forces you to go 1 mile, go with them too. Now, if you remember how this worked out, if you remember when Jesus Christ was being led up to Golgotha, he was getting ready to be, he was already carrying his cross, and he was stumbling, he was falling because of all of the torture, all of the rigor that they had put him through. Jesus falls down, and Simon of Cyrene was forced to carry Jesus' cross up the hill to Calvary. You remember that? He carried his cross all the way to Calvary. And so he was forced to do it because what the Roman soldier said, that's what happened. You didn't want to mess around. You did what they said to do. And so Jesus is saying, even if you don't have to, even if they only compel you to go 1 mile, go ahead and make that extra effort to go 2 miles. He's showing a serving spirit even against a tyrannical government. Now, I don't like government overreach any more than you do. I don't like the government telling me what to do or what not to do. But he says, if somebody forces you to go 1 mile, go ahead and double that. Go ahead and go that extra. Now, for the Jew, they absolutely hated the Romans. They did not like them. They did not want anything to do with them. Kind of like the Democrats and Republicans today. Nobody likes either one. Well, the Jews hated the Romans even more because they had taken their land. They had taken their independence, and they did not like it. And so when a Roman soldier would come up and say, hey, you're carrying my pack, what that was saying is, hey, we're in charge and you're not. And the Jews despised it. And so when Jesus said this, it must have gone off the rails. How in the world could Jesus ever say this? But yet that's what he says. What he's saying is, do more than what's required for love's sake. Love should compel us, should force us to do even more than what somebody else has us do. To go farther in a relationship than maybe what you want. To do more for somebody than what you think is required of you. A lot of people think, well, I'll give the least amount that I possibly can give. I'll do the least amount that I can possibly do. It's kind of like one of my kids in school do just the minimum requirement. I didn't name a name. I was the same way. I'll admit it. Do the minimum requirement of what's necessary to pass. That's kind of the way people live their lives. So I'm going to do the minimum necessary to show who I am, to do what I'm doing. But we need to go farther. We need to turn the other cheek and go farther. Number four, turn the other cheek and be, generous. We don't necessarily like that one. 42, give to him that asketh thee, and from him that would borrow of thee, turn not thou away. He says, be generous. Give to him that asketh thee. If somebody asks you for something, go ahead and give it to him. And from him that would borrow to thee, turn not thou away. Now, we got to be careful here. We got to be very careful here, because this is not what Jesus is saying. If a drug addict comes up to you and says, hey, I need money for a fix, you're not saying, yeah, go ahead. Here's $100. See how far that'll get you. That's not what he's saying at all. That's not what he's saying. We got to be careful in the way that we give. But if God lays something on our hearts to give, you better give. You better do what God has asked you to do. But when we give to him that asketh thee, and from him that would borrow of thee, turn not thou away. Give with no expectations. Give not expecting anything in return. When we give, we want some interest. We want some extra. But he says give with no expectations. Give to them that asketh thee, from him that would borrow, turn not away. And here's why. Because people are more important than possessions. I'm going to say it again. People are more important than possessions. No matter what we have, no matter how much or how little we have, people are always more important. John said it like this in 1 John. He said, if you see a brother that has a need and you have the means to do it, talk about the world's goods, it says, talking about money, monetary things. If you see a brother in need and you have the world's goods to meet that need and you do not give, he says, how does the love of God dwell in you? That's pretty harsh, but that's Bible. And so are we to give? Yes, we're to give with no expectations, and we are to give trusting God. As I talked about with the clothes, if somebody takes your coat, believe me, God is going to provide you another one if you are following his plan. But I want you to look at Matthew 6:33. He's talking about food. He's talking about clothing. He's talking about shelter. He says, I'll read verse 32. For after all these things do the Gentiles seek, for your heavenly Father knoweth that ye have need of all these things. Do you think God knows what you need? I've been to churches where they won't give to missions, and here's why. Well, we got to have some money and savings just in case the AC goes out or the furnace goes out, and we got to make sure this is covered and this is covered. And I understand we are to be good stewards, but good stewards is not holding on. Good stewards is giving in and taking, giving in and taking. What they're saying is, God doesn't know. God, if I give to a missionary, God doesn't know that we're going to have an air conditioner problem in 3 months. That's what we're saying. We're not trusting that God knows our needs. Does God know our needs? He absolutely knows our needs, and he always will. He says in verse 33, y'all know this verse, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. So we seek God's kingdom first. We trust in him. We follow him, which means I'm loving God and I'm loving people more than possessions. And when we love people, God is going to meet every need that we have. But if all of our concern is, I got to have this and this and this, no, I can't give to them because I'm afraid I'll miss out on something that I need, and we think that God's not going to take care of our need, the Bible says in Philippians 4:19, but my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory. God will provide the needs if we are following his will and his word. Luke Turn over there with me real quick. Luke 6:38. We're almost done, I promise. I like this verse. I'm just going to go ahead and tell you, I'm not a prosperity gospel preacher. I'm not. I don't believe in the prosperity gospel. You sow a seed of $1,000 and God's going to bless you with $10,000. I don't see that in Scripture, but I do see this in Scripture, and so this is what we're going to look at. Give, this is Luke 6:38. Give, and it shall be given unto you. We'll just stop there for a second. I like that part. Give, and it shall be given to you. If you give of yourself, if you give financially, if you give through work, if you give through this or that, if you give, it shall be given unto you. That's a promise of God. It is a promise of God. We need to believe it. Some people don't give in tithes because they say, well, I just can't afford to tithe. I'll just go ahead and tell you, I've tried it, I can't afford not to tithe. If I don't tithe, that's when we have a whole lot of problems. I can talk to you a long time about me trying to hold God's money for ransom. That I'm gonna hold on to it because I need it better than he does. No. We give it to him trusting that he is going to meet our needs. And the Bible is clear. The Bible's clear. In Malachi, he talks about opening the windows of heaven and pouring out your blessing. And he says, here, give and it shall be given to you. But then he goes on, he says, good measure, pressed down and shaken together and running over shall men give into your bosom. For the same measure that ye meet withal, it shall be measured to you again. Here's what God's saying. Here's what Jesus Christ is telling us right here. If we hold loosely to our possessions and we hold closely to people, God is going to meet every need that we have. If he's going to press it down, just think of a barrel. Think of a barrel that we got, and we're trying to get as much junk in it as possible. You push the stuff as far down as possible. You shake that thing so that all the little things go in between the big things, and you make sure that there's plenty of room. And it says shaking together, pressed down, shaking together, running over. It's going out of the barrel. That's how God is going to meet your needs. He says, men are going to give unto your bosom. He's going to just pour out these blessings to you. That's how we're supposed to give. That's how we're supposed to turn the other cheek. That's how we're supposed to be generous. That's how we're supposed to be forgiving. But turning the other cheek requires a love that only Christ can give us. You cannot for 1 minute think that you can live up to the Sermon on the Mount without Jesus Christ. We can't. And I'll just go ahead and tell you, it's difficult just because we're people to live up to the Sermon on the Mount. We struggle with this all the time, to living up to the Sermon on the Mount. So it requires this love that he has already shown you by dying on the cross for your sins. He offers this to you so that you can offer love to someone else. You cannot fully love people until first you understand the love of Jesus Christ. But when we understand that love, he pours that love into our hearts, not so that we can keep it for ourselves, but so that we can be generous with our love to other people. Turning the other cheek is not about being a doormat. Turning the other cheek is about saying that I love people. I don't want to ruin a relationship, even if they do. If they don't want me, I'm going to do my best to stand and be faithful and to love them through whatever they're going through. I think this whole section is summed up like this. It's never wrong to love first and let God deal with the consequences. It's never wrong. It's never wrong to love first. Now, that love may look a little bit different. That's not saying, wives, if you're getting beaten in your house, that's not saying you're going to stay there. That's not what that's saying at all. But we're going to love and forgive through anything. It doesn't mean that we're going to stay all the time, but it does mean I'm going to care about this person enough to where I'm not holding and trying to seek retaliation against them. Let God deal with the consequences, and he will take care of your needs. Three questions and we're gone. Are you willing to turn the other cheek? Are you willing to turn the other cheek? When something comes up, are you willing to stop the retaliation and let God handle your fight? The next one is God fighting your battles? Have you let God take control? Because we always want to fight our own battles, but God's a whole lot better fighter than we are. God can handle. Let's give it over to Him. And finally, will you trust God to take care of your needs? Many times we don't turn the other cheek. We don't help. We're not generous because we're too busy trusting our own self to meet our own needs. We can't do it. Everything that we have is from Almighty God. So let's turn it over to Him. Let's turn the other cheek and love people. Lord willing, next week, I'll just go ahead and give you a heads up. Jesus says, love your enemies. He's not joking around. He's being serious in what He's saying. Love your enemies. So can we love enough today to show the love that Christ has for us? We need to. Heads bowed and eyes closed for just a moment. Maybe you're here today and maybe you've never put your faith and your trust in Jesus Christ. Maybe you don't have this love. Maybe you can say, well, there's no possible way that I could ever turn the other cheek. Maybe it's because Jesus isn't real in your life. Maybe you've never come to Him by faith and trusted Him to be your Savior. Maybe you've never asked Jesus to save you and forgive you of all your sins. Because when He does that, He makes you a brand new creature. Now, I'm not saying that this is an easy passage to keep. Far from it. I got a long way to go in this. But what I am saying is, God will give you the strength and the ability to obey His will if you are a believer. So maybe you're here today and maybe you've never put your faith in Jesus. I'd just like to ask you to raise your hand. Nobody's looking around. Nobody's going to embarrass you in any way. But I would love to pray for you. Maybe you say, I don't know if I'm saved or I don't know. I just need some prayer right now. Is that you this morning? Just lift you up and say, yeah, would you pray for me? I don't know. If I were to die today, that I would spend an eternity in heaven. Christian, what about you? Are you letting God take care of you? Are you letting Him fight your battles? The Bible says in many passages, vengeance is mine, says the Lord, I will repay. But a lot of times we want to take the vengeance into our own hands. Are you letting God fight your own battles? Are you trusting God to take care of your needs? Maybe you say, you know what? A couple areas in my life, I've got to let God take care of me. I got to give it over to Him and just trust Him to fight my battles and to meet my needs. Anybody like that just want to slip your hand up and say, I need some prayer. Amen. Amen. Many hands all over. We're going to let God fight our battles because He is stronger than we are. But we're going to stand together. We're going to pray. Then we're going to stand together and we're going to sing, Jesus, I Come. Father, we love You. Lord, I pray that You'd help in this invitation. Do a work in our hearts. We love You and thank You and ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together. We're going to sing, Jesus, I Come to Thee. Out of my bondage, sorrow and night, Jesus, I come, Jesus, I come. Into Thy freedom, gladness and light, Jesus, I come to Thee. Out of my sickness, into Thy health, out of my want and into Thy wealth, out of my sin and into Thyself, Jesus, I come to Thee. Before we sing the next verse, just think about that. A lot of times we think we got it all together and we can figure out our own life, but it's so much better. Life is so much better when we are in Jesus Christ, when we are abiding in Him and letting Him be the King of our lives. Come to Him. If you're here today without Him, come to Him. If you are here today, maybe you're broken because of something that's been going on, maybe an issue in your life that just been dragging you down, come to Him. Out of my sickness, into Your health, out of my want, and into Your wealth. Isn't that where we want to be? But so often we want to find ourselves doing it ourselves. But let God fight our battles. Trust in Him to meet all of our needs. Let's sing one more verse.
Out of my shameful failure and loss, Jesus, I come. Jesus, I come. Into the glorious gain of Thy cross, Jesus, I come to Thee. Out of her sorrows into Thy balm, out of life's storms and into Thy calm, out of distress to jubilant song, Jesus, I come to Thee.
Amen. I like that verse. Into the glorious gain of your cross. Man, nobody in the first century would have thought the cross was a gain. But here we are in the 21st century, and we still see the gain of the cross in our own lives. What a blessing that is. Don't forget all the announcements. Come back at 6 tonight. Prayer vigil tomorrow night at 6 at the Round Church, River Cities. Senior ministry Thursday at 6:30. Come sign up for nursery and children's church. You'll be blessed, I guarantee it. I think that's all the announcements. Oh, if you did not get one of these last week and you'd help us out by filling it out so that we can update our information, or if you're a visitor, we'd just like to have your information, not to spam you. We're not gonna call you about your student loan or your credit cards or anything like that, but car warranty. None of that. But we'd just like to have some information just so that we can have a file and we can be praying for you. We'd appreciate that. If you don't have it, I think there's some back there by the camera. So pick one up and then just fill it out and put it in the offering plate. We appreciate it. Love y'all. See you tonight, hopefully. I'm going to ask Ashley if you would dismiss him.